It is my distinct honor to be able to have such an esteemed guest with me. Augustine, welcome to Singapore FinTech Festival.
Thank you very much, Tamer. Great to be with you in this festival.
So I just want to get right into it. The FinTech world is looking at development of private digital currencies, of CBDCs, and of course, there is a lot of progress being made on digital payment. And these events are not new. This has been going on for about a decade or more. So I just want to hear from you at the very onset. How do you see this is changing banking and finance around the world?
Well, you know, if you take a long enough perspective, these are not new developments. You know, for the last, you can write a history based on how money has been developing in the world. You know, I mean, shells, feathers, metals, different contraptions have been used for money. And therefore, in a way, it shouldn't surprise us that there is all this drive towards generating new forms of money. Now, what really is key in all this process is that the key aspects that make money really work in a modern society as today in a very efficient way are preserved. We have seen the evolution of money according to technology, according how new materials, new vehicles have been produced and they can be transformed into money. That's the way bills and coins in circulation came into play. First, we dominated metals, then we dominated paper. A lot of investment has been going into making those paper money non-falsificable or not forged, that you cannot forge. And therefore, it is natural that with the new technological progress in the world, that the attention goes towards implementing and using all this technology to generate means of payments. I would say that in the last 2 or 3 years, we have seen three key developments that I would say has forced us to focus a little bit more on all these developments, at least from the point of view of authorities. First, it was the major, onslaught or attention that we got out of Bitcoin. The second one was with the huge presence and more than in terms of size, but also in terms of speed, the entrance of big tech into the financial scheme, and then lastly the presence of big techs also trying to issue their own currency, like in the case of Libra Diem. So I think those three developments were very important wake-up calls. Certainly they generated the perception that things were moving far faster than at least we at the official sector anticipated. And therefore it has been a huge call for action. I would like to go back here just because this is very important to remember. What does money work? Money as we know it today is a great invention. It's something that works basically out of a process of issuing money by sovereigns that has been with us probably in the actual form for around 100 years. And it is based basically on institutional developments that allow everybody in society to trust the unit of account because it's a good store of value and because also it's a good medium of exchange. All that institutional arrangement that at the end of the day has the backing of governments and has the backing of fiscal authorities is very, very hard to replicate, obviously, in a private environment. And at the end of the day, I mean, if you distill everything to its more elementary essence, that element of trust that it is generated by the participation of the sovereign in the process makes it, at the end of the day, without a substitute. What you need is to have finality. Finality is when you receive a payment, that's the end of the story. No more paperwork, no more checks needs to happen. That's it. To get finality in that way is sort of difficult. I think for that also you need, especially when you start talking about massive payments, you need liquidity provision in intraday. And the only person who can provide that liquidity is the central bank. So I would say that innovation has been great. Innovation should continue. But there is this core aspect of money that makes it unique and that needs to be preserved. And as different experiments with private money have shown, these experiments fall one after the other because at the end of the day, the rules of the game are very difficult to observe in an absolute perfect way. And therefore, things tend to break down or they don't work as they are supposed to work. It requires a lot of precision. It should not allow for any mistakes because at the end of the day, you know, you're talking about the property of individuals and nobody wants to lose any part of their wealth or their income or their sales procedures just because the payment system doesn't work well. Technology now allows us to think on a far-reaching new payment methodology with a new central bank instrument, that is the CBDC, Central Bank Digital Currency. It would be a third type of a liability of the central bank. And depending on the shape it takes, it should add to the variety of options that individuals have. Again, given that its complexity, given that it cannot fail, central banks are taking this very, very seriously. They want to be prepared, but we don't necessarily want to rush into the issue in a reckless way. So we will be there. Today, central banks are also very active because through the systems they provide, to the services they provide, to the public goods they provide, they facilitate also innovation and make it happen. I mean, today in Singapore, just the bank you work authorizes or facilitates huge amounts of payments instantly. Can you go better than that? It's hard to think. How can it go better? So this is just an example of how immediate, very efficient payments can take place with the actual arrangements we have. Now that shouldn't give us that shouldn't be make us complacent. I think that we need to continue going, and the next step might be based on CBDC. I don't know, but this is sort of a view from 40,000 feet of how I see 500 years of history and things happening today.
Augustine, the 500 years of history really fascinates me, and I know that you care a lot about good governance of currency, and you've written speeches where you have drawn a parallel between old episodes and current episodes. So for example, Bank of Amsterdam's use of their currency in the 17th, 18th century versus the stable coins today. I think the audience here would find fascinating to hear you flesh that out a little more.
Absolutely. Bank of Amsterdam was one of the first manifestations of a proper bank. It introduced account banking. It basically, at the time, around the 17th and 18th century, the main activity of these institutions was trade financing. At the end of the day, this bank would receive deposits in coins, in metals, and would receive these deposits, and then it would issue papers validating that those deposits, and then those deposits were meant to be backed 100% by metals. And the issue is that those deposits started to be used as payment vehicles. And given the solidity of the institution, they were widely acceptable, and so things for many years went really well. But at some point, it was perceived that the flexibility was needed, and that this ironclad rule of 100% backing started to break down. At some point, this flexibility went farther than what it was prudent, and some problems started to appear. And of course, that basically undermined the trust of those deposits of payment need, and eventually it produced a run against the institution. And once you start issuing paper that is not fully backed, and you have a run, well, you have a hole, and if the government doesn't want to finance it, then the game is over. And that is basically what happened. So I would say the message here goes in two directions. One, I think in good faith, people at that time discovered that an ironclad rule of 100% backing was very difficult to sustain to provide good service to your clients. You need some form of flexibility. Now, once you start going on the flexibility, you can also enter into very, very, very sharp sliding slope. And eventually, it breaks down. I mean, what history tells us is that this type of arrangement based on stable coins, I mean, this is what Bank of Amsterdam was trying to do, is to produce a modern day stable coin. We have this. This is not a new idea. We had it in Bank of Amsterdam. We have it today, for example, in Hong Kong, with the currency board. Now, something that has made the currency board of Hong Kong very sustainable and unquestionable is the fact that the application of the principles is done in a very decisive way. But this tells you that not much flexibility that the flexibility that is there is hard to produce without fiscal support. And that's what other types of fiat currency is important. And that's why we are where we are today. So the issue is that when you're producing money that depends for its value on how much of other type of asset do you hold, introduces tremendous amount of challenges, and eventually it's very hard to sustain such a system.
Absolutely, and just like in those days, there were seigneuries, there were ways of counterfeiting money. These days we have risks of hacking and theft and fraud as well with modern day currencies. Augustine, staying with the central bank on the currency world, so there are two sorts of central bank digital currencies. One, of course, we've had for decades, which is the central bank to commercial bank, the wholesale digital currency, if you will. And then the frontier right now, the tantalizing prospect of a retail digital currency where the central bank can skip the banks and go straight to the public. So where do you see these two evolving in the coming years?
Well, I mean, as you know, we have been dealing with the wholesale CBDC already, I would say, even for decades. And therefore, now the challenge in that field is how can we perfection its use? How can we make it wider? How can we integrate it further with other technologies to make more efficient other type of activities? In the Innovation Hub of the BIS here in Switzerland, we just rolled out our first CBDC prototype, where basically through a wholesale CBDC, we can facilitate the settlement of asset transactions that are represented by tokens. And in this case, the use of CBDC turned out to be extremely useful. So here, basically, we're integrating a payment application with another financial type of activity, which is the settlement of asset transactions. So what we can see in the future is how this wholesale representation of money that basically works for transactions done by commercial banks and some particular payment service providers can generate more value added in the whole chain of financial services. Another, in this line, a huge application that needs to be worked out, that the BIS is very active and other countries are active, is to facilitate the settlement of cross-border transactions. That is an aspect that we still are way behind. I would say that if there is something where more work needs to be done is in terms of cross-border transactions, especially for retail, and to have schemes where central banks are involved and settlement is in wholesale currency, CBDCs, that might be a way to go. And we have many examples today of efforts going in that direction. Now, the big challenge, what is completely new, is CBDC for retail. Central banks, most of the central banks that we have today abandoned the territory of providing accounts and providing services to individuals many decades ago. So the issue of having a CBDC for retail implies it can imply either individuals having accounts at the central bank or the issue of tokens, who would be much more closer to the issuance of bills. So this is a completely new ballgame. I mean, for the last decades, central banks have not been thinking in providing direct services to individual by electronic means. And as a matter of fact, this has been a very explicit decision by central banks, which is to the core of the payment system, which is central bank money, not in the form of retail, but in terms of wholesale CBDC or reserves, as we know them today, to allow for a second tier of services that go the last mile to the individuals and firms to be developed. And there is where we see a lot of innovation and where we hope that we will see more innovation and where the central bank public good of providing fiat money has the highest potential. So the issue is do we want to roll that back and go and bring central banks back to providing services to individuals? And that is an area where we don't have expertise. I would say central banks do not have today the technological developments to make that happen. It would require a major revolution in any society. Yes, there are progress, and we have clear examples, like, for example, in the case of China. But that's a huge undertaking, and I'm not absolutely sure if every single country should deploy the amount of resources that are needed to for that to happen. So I would say that in the CBDC field, pretty much all central banks are working on it. Central banks want to be prepared. There is no one size fits all. For this to happen, it will be a sovereign decision of each country something that might not be obvious to everybody. It needs to make sense first as a solution to the local or to the domestic problems that the country or that the landscape in payments require. The international presence of CBDC is not necessarily immediately in the minds of central banks. We should make provisions for it to happen, but the driver here is mostly the local needs of society. At the end of the day, we should think of CBDC as an instrument. It's an instrument that the central bank has. And how can that instrument be used to facilitate the needs of society? Inclusion is very important. Obviously, that has attracted huge attention, and that might be a vehicle to further financial inclusion with huge societal benefits. So, again, we need as central banks to think very carefully how are we going to do it. But it's a huge challenge. It's a huge challenge for central banks to give the step going from providers of wholesale central bank to, in addition, provide retail services.
Right. So through the history of central banking, we have seen the central bank act as lenders of the last resort. They have been very successfully doing cross-border settlements at the corporate and individual level. You just talked in depth about the possible last mile solutions central banks can possibly offer, subject to some technological hurdles and resource constraints. But then, Augustine, are there any problems related to payment that central banks cannot solve? And if that is the case, what is the role of private digital currencies?
Yes, I mean, I think there is huge territory that central banks do not cover. I mean, as a matter of fact, if you see what the landscape we have today, we just take care of payments among big players, and that's to the wholesale spectrum. And then we take care of payments at the more atomized level through currencies, through bills and cash and bills. In between, there is huge space to innovate and huge space to provide solutions. And there is where the role for innovation in payments is essential. In filling all the gaps that are in between those two pillars, I would say, that are the contribution that central banks do today, there might be some space for privately issued currencies. At the end of the day, my thinking is that it would be more than anything as a part of the utility to provide payment systems that at the end of the day end up settled in central bank money. I mean, again, we go to the beginning of our discussion where I established the centrality, I would say, of central banks in any payment environment. And I think that centrality is very difficult to avoid. Now, in some form, a central bank, private issued, might have some space. But where I see that there is the most space is in bringing financial and payment services to the population and integrating also payment services with other type of financial services and enhance the overall value added that financial services can be bring to individuals. My point is that central bank money and central bank produced fiat money it's extremely difficult to replicate. It really hasn't been done, and any private money that exists out there has very limited application. I mean, we can think, for example, of privately issued money, the miles that you get in the airlines, you know, that can take you so far. But, you know, just to give you an example, from time to time, they say to fly from Basel to Singapore, you require 100,000 miles. And the next day they say, you require 150,000 miles. So they just depreciated the currency there, you know, and those adjustments go one and over again. And at the end of the day, it makes it very difficult for you to accept your salary in miles, you know. They're very inflexible, hard to use, and also hard to assure its value. So that's the way I see it. I mean, there is space for everybody, but there are some aspects that some parties do much better than others, and that's the case of central banks and fiat currency.
Right. I mean, I think that point that, you know, there are multiple axes of usability and flexibility and reliability, and many of those axes are, of course, dominated by the sovereign. I think that's a point we take very well. But I think this audience will be also heartened by your assertion that there is a huge amount of space for non-central bank actors also in the world of payment and perhaps even private digital currencies. Augustine, we are unfortunately run out of time, but it's been an immense pleasure to be able to share this screen with you. So thank you so much again.
Thank you. It's my pleasure, and congratulations for the FinTech Festival. Next year, hopefully you invite me again, but instead it will be physical. And instead of having a fireside chat in Singapore, we have a poolside chat in Singapore.
Ojalá. Thank you.
Okay.